Good morning. Welcome to Knit Luck TV, episode 3. Third week in a row that we're doing our little vlog. Week 1 was a little introduction. Last week we talked a little bit about how I felt that knitting can change your life, and I gave a few short specific examples of how that changed my life, but I didn't really explain the chain of events that led to those life changes to sort of prove how the knitting actually made those changes. So I hope to talk about that today. Also wanted to do something novel, share what I'm knitting. Haven't done that yet. So we've got a couple projects or proto projects in the works where I haven't really swatched yet. I'm looking forward to sharing those with you. And I think that's what we're going to stick with today. First off, again, we're increasing in the number of subscribers. We are now up to 7 subscribers. So if you want to be one of those 7, join the club, get an alert every week in your Gmail account that I've posted a new vlog, and hopefully join us, because I like sharing this stuff with you, because alas, as I say every week, I do not have my own knitting group. Makes me a little crazy, makes me a little sad. So this right now is my knitting group. I'm not knitting, but I'm talking. Maybe I should grab the knitting. But thank you for joining us, and I hope you continue to do so. So, like I said, I want to talk a little bit about how exactly did knitting change my life. You know, I mentioned last week how lifelong knitters don't know what the heck that I'm talking about, because knitting is just one of those things that they've always done. They don't remember a time before knitting. They've always had this amazing, you know, centering occupation to keep them grounded. Or even they don't realize that it keeps them grounded. It's just another occupation. But when you spend 26 of your years of your life not knitting, and then find it and realize, wow, this is a lot of fun. It's very relaxing. I feel it's given me confidence that I've been able to make something that I can actually wear, and not look like a hobo. That's a plus. That was a really big freaking deal for me, and I'll tell you a little more why. So I was always really into using my hands and crafting. My earliest memory of crafting, my mom was a big cross stitcher, and I would try to cross stitch my own little patterns. And, you know, my mom, God love her, I'm sure she was worried that I would hurt myself with a needle, or she would be like, oh, well, you have to use a pattern. And when I was really proud of what I had made, this little thing, and experimenting with myself, that's a really important thing to do for your kids, is when they discover something, you nudge them in the direction that they're in, and applaud what they are already doing, because otherwise it just makes them feel like they're not doing well enough. They're not, you know, it's a big step for a kid to try something new. So whenever they do, get really excited about it, and find ways to encourage that excitement. I don't blame my mom. You know, I get nervous around needles too. But I feel like there is a better way. And that's sort of the joy of, and how humans change over time, is that we learn as parents to do better things for our kids, and hopefully improve our kids' lives in ways that we can't even imagine. So that was sort of my first entree into craft. And that was maybe at the age of 5. And I've always been around people crafting. I used to watch forever my mom doing all these little cross stitches. My grandmother knitted, and she tried to teach me how to knit, but there was a little mistake. I'm left-handed, okay? And people kept trying to teach me left-handed knitting. Well, there's one thing. If you're teaching someone how to knit and they're left-handed, before you try teaching them left-handed knitting, ask them how much they use their left hand. Are they, you know, do they cut scissors with the left hand? Do they write left-handed? Do they eat left-handed? Do they swing a bat left-handed? Do they throw a ball left-handed? Because I only write and eat with my left hand. Everything else is right-handed. And so when people would teach me how to knit in the left-handed style, completely confused. My brain was just not processing that information at all. And I honestly thought I would never learn to knit, and I gave up on it. I almost had a snooty attitude towards knitters, because I secretly wanted to be one, because I just couldn't get it. And I thought, you know, if my grandmother can't teach me and my mom can't teach me, I'm never going to learn. And fast forward 25 years, and or no, maybe 20 years, and I had been quilting and beading, and I enjoyed those things, but just as a pastime, like in a casual way. It made me happy, but it wasn't something I was passionate about. And so one day I was working at a trade show, and I think one of the other representatives in a booth nearby to me was Potter Craft, a publisher of craft and lifestyle books. And they had, I think it might not have been Potter Craft, but it was Weekend Knitting was sitting there. And I looked through it and I fell in love with the fantasy of knitting right there and then, like the beautiful warm hand knits keeping you toasty, the fall weather, the hanging out with sheep, you know, in Weekend Knitting, there's even a picture of someone knitting in the bathtub, which is completely unrealistic, but it's a lovely fantasy. The best I ever got was reading knitting magazines in the bathtub, which got me through my first child's, you know, earliest days. The only way I could really get some rest and me time was reading knitting magazines in the bathtub. So if you're a new mom on the way, that's my secret tip of getting a little me time in the first 3 weeks of a new baby. So yeah, I completely fell in love with that fantasy, but I still didn't pick up the needles. Not sure why. I was probably busy working or just didn't have the time. But it got to the point one day I had recently gotten married, and it wasn't a great relationship. It was just two people who on paper looked like it would be a really good thing together, but it really wasn't. At least from my perspective. And the less said about that, the better. But some tragedy happened, and I found myself all by myself and kind of stuck and really in grief and sadness, you know, because some bad things had happened, and I didn't know what to do. Like, really kind of lost. My mom has no patience for a lot of dwelling and sadness, and so she told me to snap out of it. And the only thing I could think to do was go to my local Michael's and buy a learn to knit kit, and I sat my butt down and I taught myself how to knit. This was the first time I actually did it myself, where like there was no other person around me. I had a Lion Brand learn to knit kit and everything else I needed. And I just sat down and I did it, gripping my poor little knitting needles, like, you know, trying to keep the stitches from falling off, you know, gripping them with like the death grip of, you know, to ensure that there would be no drop stitches in my knitting, which is probably why I'm still to this day a very tight knitter. I have no patience for loose knitting. It doesn't last as long. It doesn't wear well. And it doesn't show off the knitting stitches or a stitch pattern as well. So I'm a very picky, tight knitter, even now. But in the process of learning how to knit, I developed something I wasn't really expecting. And it probably comes from not thinking that I couldn't learn how to knit, that I would never learn to knit. But as my scarf grew and those first rows of garter stitch came into existence, like, I got more and more excited. Like, that I was able to, this is some little thing that I was able to achieve when the whole rest of my life felt like it was kind of out of control. Like I was in a job that I didn't love. I was in a relationship that I was trying really hard to make work and it just wasn't. And at that time I really didn't know why I was so unhappy, because like if you looked at it all, I should have been very happy. Like anybody else would have been really, really, really happy with their lives. And I thought there was something seriously wrong with me, that I was so unhappy, and it was very hard and created a lot of depression and stress. And so when I found something, this one thing that brought calm and peace, fulfillment and accomplishment into my life, I dove into that sucker head first and became, one could say, obsessed, maybe a little. I started, you know, this was 2004. This was the advent of knitting blogs and seeing that I could not just learn to knit and find connection within myself, but find connection with other knitters was a complete breakthrough for me because I was very lonely. I didn't have many friends. Most of my friends lived out of state or out of the region, and I was a very lonely person. And so knitting gave me a path, like something that I could feel confident talking about or expressing interest in, that eventually I started to find other local knitters and attending my own knitting group, or not my knitting group. It was actually a good friend of mine, Warren, who opened up a short-lived yarn shop in San Rafael, and he, before his shop opened, he had a little trunk show at his house, where I, like, for the first time, I met other people as excited about knitting as I was. Like, he brought out these beautiful skeins of yarn, and we all oohed and awed, and it finally occurred to me that I was around my people. And that was huge. I mean, can you imagine someone who really didn't have a whole lot of friends most of her life, due to, you know, all kinds of circumstances, but finally finding people that she could connect with? And I mean, and I, at that knit night, I actually met, the person who would become my friend, who would introduce me not just to tabletop board gaming and RPGs, but also, I ended up meeting, the love of my life, my soulmate, my partner, she brought me to a, Dungeons and Dragons game, and there he was, you know, still complete shock that that ever happened, but it was because of knitting. You know, I learned to knit, I started becoming more active in the knitting community, and it opened up a whole new world, like, and not just knitting, all kinds of things. Which in turn led me to jobs. I ended up working for a yarn company for a short period of time. I ended up, the people that I became friends with because of my friend Adrian, who I met at that knitting group, eventually employed me and taught me how to build websites, which is why Knit Luck is even in existence. And knitting itself, because I became a knitting blogger, taught me, gave me the foundation to be able to do those jobs. So, you know, when you find something that lights a spark within yourself, you got to just grab onto it. And knitting was that for me. And I'd like to think that there are other people who feel that way besides myself. And that's why when I encounter friends who are going through really hard times, or I just feel maybe need something, I give them a little learn to knit kit. Because sometimes when you're going through a hard time, there's no easy path. You don't know which way is up, let alone which way is out. And for me, knitting was able to just create something. At the time, when I first started, it was a scarf. But eventually, it became a whole life. And that's why Knit Luck is called Better Living Through Knitting, because I fully believe that knitting gave me the better life that I was looking for. And which is why now, as a vlogger, a video blogger, I'm trying to reach out to my fellow knitters, because I don't have a knitting group right now. There isn't really one in my local area that I like to go to. The other ones are really great, but just too far to drive, especially having small kids. And it is a dream of mine to have my own yarn shop. I know it will not make me a ton of money, but I just want to create a home for knitters where they feel comfortable and welcome, with excellent customer service, knowledgeable knitters. And, you know, actually my dream yarn shop is Pearlescence down in Silicon Valley. They are amazing. I remember when they first started splitting off from another yarn shop. What they've done with their company and the level of service and community that they provide inspires me all the time. And it also makes me mad because they're so far away that I can't attend their knit nights, but I think of them often. Another great knit night in the Bay Area is at Nine Rubies in San Mateo. Those are some very kind, very knowledgeable knitters over there. I'm sure there are more yarn shops. I don't get to visit all of them. I have two small children. I'm lucky if I even get to go to Stitches, but I'm going this year. And remind me, I need to make a hotel reservation for that, because I want to make it an overnight. I want to wake up without children just for a day. So that's why I'm doing this. This video blog is to create more community. And I hope I can encourage you guys to do your own video blogs and link to it in the comments. I'll mention it on Knitluck if you ping me and let me know that you've done a response blog. That's what it's called, a response blog. Because that's what the internet's for. It's to connect us. That's the point, people. We need to make connections, because otherwise we're all just doing things in these little bubbles and no one gets to know your special sauce. So I fully encourage you, investigate. How does your computer capture video? See if you can make it work, because it's fun. It's really great to be able to express yourself in this way and share your knitting truth. So please, I asked about it last week. No one did it. I want to try to do it this week. But I've been talking a long time about how knitting personally changed my life in a little more detail. And I also wanted to share, I want to make this only about 20 minutes because you've got a busy day. You don't want to sit here all day. And I just want to share a few things, like what I'm knitting right now. I keep mentioning on the blog, I did a Year of Projects post yesterday of what I'm knitting, and it is this. This is the textured shawl. You can see me. Hi, peekaboo. It's in progress, so you can't really tell. I can't see what you're seeing right now. But it is a shawl that has alternating sections of garter stitch and stockinette. And so it makes a really lovely ribbed sort of situation. It's a semicircle shawl, so it almost looks like, you know, the ripples of a wave when you throw a pebble in a still pond. And which is why it was like, I had to knit this. It was in last year's Knitwear, now known as Knit Pearl. My husband got me the copy of the magazine as a anniversary gift, and I cried because that's like, you know, he knows me. He knows what's the best thing that will make me super happy, and that's knitting magazines, anything knitting. So that's what I'm knitting right now. I'm using a yarn called Wool Candy, which is not in existence anymore. It's a theme in my life. I fall in love with the yarn, and they go out of business, and which is why maybe I should own a yarn shop and or a wholesale yarn company. It's a dream of mine. If I don't have a yarn shop one day, I would really love to find a way to reproduce this yarn. Back in the early days of Knitluck, I've talked about this. There's one yarn company that I think knitters as a whole are missing out because it doesn't exist anymore. And it's called Goddess Yarns, and they were like all natural yarns, all natural fibers. Maybe there was one or two with a little nylon in it just because of the way the fiber works. It does perform better with nylon. But this is my all-time favorite yarn. You can't see it. This is Goddess Yarns. It's a little bright on the bright side. You can't see it. All right. Well, it's Goddess Yarns. It's Ellen. It's a combination of wool and cotton. And I'm still blown away to this day. And this yarn has to be almost a decade old. It has the elasticity of wool, but the kind of dry feeling, the soft feeling of cotton. And I found a whole bunch of this on eBay. I have 25 skeins of it. And I finally found the pattern, and I've had this yarn for probably 3 or 4 years. I found the pattern. I talked about it in episode 1. It's this. On the cover of this month's Interweave Knits. This looks like a beautiful pattern. The yarn itself is a bit dark, and so you're not going to be able to see the stitch pattern as much as you would with the yarn that the pattern uses, but I'm okay with that. So that's on the agenda. I braved the storage unit. I had to climb over boxes. It was a little scary, but I found it, and now it's back at home where it belongs. Yay! I also have this yarn from Art Fibers. It's a merino and silk blend. I mean, look at that. It's gorgeous. It looks Madeline Tosh-ish or Dream in Color-ish, if you will. And I've been looking for a hat pattern, like a beret tam thing to make with it, but I can't find one right now that I really love. I have one in a single skein book somewhere, but I'm still kind of want to make something with like a cabled brim and then a pew, like a nice little beret top. So I might give that a whirl. Why not? Why not? Maybe that'll be my first knitting pattern. Who knows? Well, maybe we'll give that a try. Anyway, so that's where I am with knitting. And it's nice to be video blogging with you again. And I'm glad you could join me. And thank you so much for being a part of Knit Luck TV episode 3. I hope you have a fantastic week and that you'll tune in again next Monday in the afternoon when it'll post. All right. Thanks. Bye.